tonight. I invite us to come back together. I am seated up here with three of the brothers who have preached today, and I expressed this to them personally, but would just say, and I'm so grateful for God's word and how it's been communicated, just the picture, the glory of the Father, the glory of the Son, the glory of the Spirit, God, the Trinity, as we've seen unfolded today from Psalm 98 to Matthew 7 to all over Scripture with the Holy Spirit. So I pray that you love the Lord more as a result of time in His Word today under the teaching of these brothers. So thank you, brothers. And then someone who is maybe new to this group, I know has been in various breakouts, and many of you know Zane Pratt. But Zane has served. Give a little background, how long you served overseas, and then, yeah.
So about a total of 23, 24 years overseas, most of it Central Asia, some in Southeast Asia.
And then the Lord led him back to, he was at Southern Seminary for a while, then back overseas, and then when I stepped in my role in the IMB, I asked Zane to come back from overseas to lead. He leads our training across the IMB, across the International Mission Board, and is helping fuel good, strong, biblical theology, ecclesiology, missiology across the fabric of not only what we do, but hope in a way that encourages brothers and sisters in many different contexts. So what we're going to talk about over the next few minutes is how the Holy Spirit leads and calls us in mission. Maybe I should put calling first, how the Spirit calls us and leads us in mission. Obviously, we just heard exhortation, truths from the Word. What I want us to dive into in the next few minutes is, so practically, how does that play out in our lives, especially as we've kind of set up, even last night on the panel, set up part of the purpose of this conference is praying that God would send out missionaries from among this group to go across barriers for the spread of the gospel to unreached people and places. And so I want us to think together about how the Spirit calls people to do that. Because I'm guessing there's some, maybe many, I hope in a sense all of us asking the question, how do I know the Spirit is calling me to do something? Can I know the Spirit is calling me, and how do I know? So I want to set things up, and then I'm going to try to get in your shoes and ask questions and have them kind of speak to me as if they're speaking to a student who's asking some of these questions. So I want to set up some categories from the very beginning. When we think calling, I think it's just helpful for us to realize that the majority of times that calling, that word is used in Scripture, it's actually referring not to some subjective leading in this or that area to this or that task. It's referring to salvation in Christ. And so calling primarily is a call to Christ, to Himself, call to holiness in Christ, call to freedom in Christ, a call to suffering in Christ, all of these realities we see in the New Testament. So when you think calling, I want to encourage you to think first, I'm called to Christ, and to rest your identity there, that what is most important in my life is that I'm a child of God, and that's my identity now, and that is the unshakable foundation of my identity for the next 10 billion years and beyond. And so to root calling there, salvation in Christ, and then call to salvation, then second, I think, call to mission, in the sense, and mission in a Matthew 28, 18, 19, 20, go and make disciples. So we're all called, in a sense, to be disciple makers wherever we live. So there's not a special calling to make disciples. As disciples, we're called to make disciples. Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. So we've been called to mission, really commanded to mission in that sense. So that's not what we're discussing. How do I know if I'm called to make disciples? If you have the Spirit of Christ in you, you're called to make disciples for Christ. The last two categories of calling that I want us to think about are call to station and then a call to service. So think, all right, call to salvation, call to mission, but then call to station. So this is where every one of us has different stations in life. We have a station in family. We're sons or daughters. Maybe we'll be wives or husbands or moms or dads. And so we have responsibilities in family. Maybe some, and Scripture talks about a call to singleness. So we've got station there, call to station, think membership in the church. I'm called to be a member of this church, this local body of believers, or called to be a citizen in a community, in a country, and there are obligations that go with each of those kind of callings. And then, so that's, I want to talk a little bit about that, and then dive into last, and this is where we're going to spend the bulk of our time, the call to service. And that's basically how God, what we see in Scripture, Him doing. I think Acts 16 is John referenced the Holy Spirit leading Paul where to go on mission. So how the Spirit directs disciples to make disciples in a certain way, in a certain place, through a certain vocation, at a certain time, and how does the Lord do that work of leadership? So I want to step back, though, call to station, because I'm guessing there are some people here who are wondering, is God calling me to be married? And if He's calling me to be married, who's He calling me to marry? I'll confess, I did not do this well as a college student. My wife, who's sitting over here, we'd been dating for about 3 years and in college, and she's wondering what's happening next. And I, one day she said, well, when you think about the future, what do you think? And I said, well, I don't know if I'm called to be married. And she was like, well, that's helpful. So anyway, I'm sitting up here on a panel with Richard Chen, who you heard earlier, who is newly married over the last 3 months ago. So, Richard, let me ask you the question. I mean, you were in that seat asking those questions over these last days, maybe to give us a little background and help us think through. Okay, so if I'm a student, for students who are thinking through, how do I know if I'm called to be married or who to marry? How do you think through discernment along those lines?
Sure. Well, David, you young, good-looking student, you.
Thank you.
firstly, my story, just in case you don't know, I was actually married for 23 years to a beautiful wife named Bronwyn. We were students together at the University of New South Wales in Sydney, in Australia, both studying to be medical doctors. And I eventually gave that up to go into full-time ministry. I was looking for someone who would enable me to keep doing that or going down that path. And she came along and wanted to, well, assist me in that task, which was incredible. My long story, but I'll cut it short. But in the kindness yet severe mercy of God, she was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer about 4 years ago. If you know anything about pancreatic cancer, it is about the worst of the cancers you can get. It's one that gets undetected for a long period of time. And when she was diagnosed, it was in stage four, and she was given 6 months to live. But in the kindness of God, we went through various procedures. God gave her 3 years, and over that time, my dear children, we have four children, were able to see her become more beautiful as a Christian, and she died well. She just became more and more like Jesus. And the reason I prayed for Yemen tonight is because she would go through CT scans, and that's a long time to spend in CT scans and various scans, and she would pray for Yemen while she was getting scanned. That even in her dying stages, she was thinking about world mission. I was just sorry for myself. I was just sorry for my children. I was sorry for our state, but she was thinking about world mission, which was a great rebuke to me. And not only did she pray for Yemen, she actually prayed that I would find someone else. And I didn't want to talk to her about remarriage at all. I always cut her off in conversation. But she wanted to, and she knew that I didn't want to. She knew that I didn't really want to spend any time talking about it. I would cut her off. She would just submissively keep quiet. But I knew that in her prayers, she was praying for someone. And God answered her prayers in bringing along beautiful Jeanette, who I married 3.5 months ago. Now, how did I go about looking for Jeanette, though? Because that's the kind of question, because I'm a little wiser now, you know, compared to then. Mind you, God provided me with a beautiful wife in Bronwyn. So I went, firstly, young David student, to the Bible. I went to the Bible, the supreme authority in all matters of life, faith, and then went, Jeanette, it was there. No, it was not that. The Bible's very clear on certain things, isn't it? So it's clear that if you're going to marry someone, that person has to be A, of the opposite sex. It's clear, crystal clear. Secondly, the person has to be free to marry. So they're not married themselves, or they're free to marry. And thirdly, they must be a believer if you are a believer. I think there's three explicit commands of God. They fit all those three categories. If you marry someone like that, you're free to marry, you're a Christian, you fit those categories, then you, when you marry, you're not sinning. That's crystal clear from the scriptures, right? You're not sinning if you do. Now, after that, you need to think through wisdom categories. It's wise, therefore, to actually marry someone who's of the same maturity Christianly, someone who will share the same heartbeat as you in terms of ministry and theological conviction, someone who desires the same desires coming out of the scriptures as your primary authority in all matters of life, faith, and conduct. Now, Jeanette met all those categories in every single way. She was actually longing to stay single and go to Japan, but I ruined her life and married her in the process. So that's why I prayed for Japan as well, right? Now, that was guidance, yeah? So therefore, they're the kinds of things I'm thinking about, and she shared those convictions, and I think it's really important to share the same theological convictions. And there might be small differences here and there, but the closer they are, I think the wiser it is, so you can know that you're not going to be arguing about these things should you be on the mission field, should you be in any area of ministry. Now, it does help to like them too, kind of enjoy that, and so I like Jeanette.
Good. So don't marry somebody I don't like.
Yeah. That's right. That's good. It's helpful. Helpful to marry someone that you like in the front. So they're the wisdom categories that are added to that, if I can say that. Hmm. But the first three have to be absolutely foundational.
That's good. And obviously, so the reason I even set up like the call to salvation, mission, station is all of those are going to inform how God leads and guides us in different ways at different times. So, with that background, here I sit. I'm at this conference. I'm hearing you all talk about the need for the gospel to go to unreached people, praying for senders to go out from here. And I'm assuming everybody should be open to being a sender. So if I'm, should at least be a sender and open to being a goer. So how do I, can I know if the Lord is leading me to go? And if so, how can I know? Somebody help me. All I've got so far is marry someone you like. Like, I need...
Amen.
I need, which is helpful. Which is so helpful. But I need more. I kind of was expecting a little more.
I'll start, and then John can tell me where I'm too precise.
It's good. We'll start with the Presbyterian.
Thank you.
It's good.
No, this is my 2 minute just do something. And by the way, anytime anyone says just do something, I get a quarter. Just anytime, anywhere in the world, someone says just do something. It's similar to what Richard just said. You establish what are the things that we know Scripture says about the gospel, all of the glorious things that we've been hearing proclaimed today. And you set up those as your parameters, and give everyone here, every one of us is in absolute agreement that every sort of experience we ever had needs to be tested according to the Word of God. We're all in agreement as well that God gives us experiences and we're thankful for them. So how do those things relate? And I like the way that young David here has asked the question, because there are other questions we could talk about. We could think about how do we describe our own experiences in life? How do we understand the verses that John talked about relative to the word call or the Spirit, Paul resolving in the Spirit, and we may get to those. But he's specifically asking the question that many of you are asking, help me make a decision. And that sets us on a certain trajectory. And this is what I want, why I wrote Just Do Something, and what I want to guard against. I don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. I'm not against making subjective decisions based on a gut or an intuition. But what I'm aware of is many college students are prone to a hyper-subjectivity, a kind of hyper-spirituality in the way in which they approach decisions. So I think you do much as Richard said, with wisdom. You ask people, you pray, you ask the Lord to search your heart, your motives, your understanding, you talk to your church, you talk to your friends, you get a sense, what's the feedback people's giving you, you talk to people, you realize where the need is, and then you do want to have some subjective sense of 1 Timothy 3:1, that's about eldership, but it relates, there's a desire. Or as we were talking over dinner where Paul says, it was my ambition to preach Christ. Or the passage that John mentioned from Acts, I resolved. So there is that reflection of something in your heart, desire, ambition, resolve. Now my caution is not to over-spiritualize that reflection upon our own desire and ambition. So the question about guidance, and here I'll finish, then we'll have a good conversation. Does God guide us? Does God lead us? As John said, in 10 years, you're going to be able to... He led you to Southeast Asia. Absolutely believe that. The question that I think is prior to that, however, is does God promise to give us that guidance ahead of time before we get there? We may be able to, I can look back and say, I went to this seminary and part of why God led me there was that I would meet my wife. And I didn't know that when I made that step. I didn't understand everything that God was doing to guide me and lead me. And I don't see in Scripture a promise that God will give us the next step by some internal subjective sense of what that next step ought to be. May he do it? May he give us a profound experience, a sense of calm, a sense of peace, an overwhelming sense of I want to do that? Absolutely. My caution is I don't see a promise that he will give us that next step of guidance in every case, so that sometimes we connect the need and we have some desire, and we just do something. That was maybe 4 minutes.
So what do you want to deny? I mean, is it certainty? Is that what you're denying? That to next step tonight, you may not be given a certain guidance. I'm not clear on what you want to deny.
I would think of two types of people. One sort of person who would come to their pastor or to one of us and say, wonderful time at Cross, God is calling me to Bangladesh. He's calling me. I know he's calling me. I think pastoral counsel would say, let's talk about that. Who are you? What does the church say? You know, the famous Spurgeon story, you know, God's calling me to preach, and well, he didn't tell me that, young man, you can sit down. So what I'm wanting to guard against, it is possible to wrongly interpret our own subjective sense. The other person I'm thinking of is the person who, not emotionally cramped, we don't want emotionally cramped people, that's not a synonym for Presbyterians.
It is for Anglican, but that's another story.
Oh, you can say that. But the person who is saying, yeah, I'd like to do that, I think, and I see the need, and I'm kind of excited, and I know the gospel, I think I'll do that. And there's no overwhelming, I just felt the call, but they heard the Great Commission, and so they're going. So it's both the person who is over-interpreting their experience and the person who may not have that super subjective sort of experience, and they're still going to be wonderful missionaries on the field.
So what you're denying is God doesn't promise a certain kind of experience, right? Certain kind of experience by which you discern the next step. Mm-hmm. But that's different, isn't it, than saying this: good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. So I'd want to say that's a promise that you can bank on. Now, the details of how you become subjectively convinced that any particular step is next is not in that verse. We agree with that. But I think I want to, you know, when I said in 10 years you're going to be there, you can count on the Holy Spirit to do that. I want to say that. I still want to say that. And I want them to ask for that regularly, because you have not because you ask not. God gives guidance. And so I think every morning we should pray, lead me in paths of righteousness for your name's sake, specific paths of good deeds today and right things to do today and right choices to make today. So I think we're okay with that. And then, hope.
Well, can I press on that?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think David, he's really being helped by this.
I'm just trying to figure out my life.
Oh, that's right.
Kevin DeYoung and John Piper just kind of going at it.
I forgot about you.
That's all right.
Of course, I agree with that, Mike. My question would be, in his way, in that context, that verse is about the way of righteousness. So are there decisions in life that are non-moral decisions? And in those cases, does that give us a promise that God will lead us and show us ahead of time which path to take on whether it's mission sending agency A or sending agency B, both of which are wonderful?
Yeah, I think it does.
From the text, you think that way means any decision we have, God subjectively leads us.
Right. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. I don't think I use that word, subjectively.
Okay, so say what you were saying.
I think you can, you're facing two moral decisions. They're both good, that neither is sin.
Right.
Can I pray and believe God will lead me to the one that, and then you have to fill in what your hopes and dreams are, will glorify him most, will build my faith most, will be most fruitful in the world. You know, what is your life about? That's why big decisions have to be made about why you're on the planet before you can ask him to do that. But here's the way I would argue for that, namely from James 1, let him who lacks wisdom ask God, and he will give, not withholding. And because the man who asks with a double-minded man, he won't get any answer. So if it takes wisdom, the wisdom route, to discern between two good choices, God promises to give that wisdom. You still do it. You make a choice, and it may be relatively clear to you, and it may not be relatively clear
that's
to you.
Important.
And that's what I think you're stressing. But here's what we haven't. Here's the comeback that I haven't given, dear student.
Thanks. Back to me.
I think it's good and right for you to go home tonight and get on your knees and ask God to show up at this conference with an unusual sense of what he's calling you to do. An unusual sense. If I were charismatic, I'd probably use other phrases, a prophetic word or divine revelation or something, but just whatever you want to call it. Is that okay? Tell him that.
Do you, or do you not want me to pray tonight?
I do want you to pray. Before you pray for that, I would pray for the things that we know Scripture has promised to us, Lord, search my heart and try me. See what wicked way there is in me. Lord, am I motivated by fear? Help me to see if my attitude is righteous. Help me to see if I'm not understanding myself correctly, if I've not understood the gospel. Help me to listen to good counselors. Absolutely, James 1, God gives us wisdom. So I don't have a problem counseling you to pray about that. I guess the caution that I would make, and I don't think John would make, is I'm not confident. I don't have a promise from Scripture, because I don't interpret Proverbs in that same way. I don't have a promise from Scripture that God is going to give that to you. So I don't want you to be concerned.
I didn't say this text promises that subjective answer. This is objective guidance here. I'm saying it's not wrong to want that thing that's not promised.
Sure.
Not wrong.
Right.
I don't think you're promised to be filled with the Holy Spirit tonight. And you should ask for it desperately with tears. And I think part of that experience of the fullness of the Holy Spirit is often, just often, not always and not promised, an extraordinary, sweet confidence that this is the way, walk in it. And it might be very general, it might be very specific. And then from our supper, I know that Richard, sitting there, would want us to say, and I said, let's say it over and over, that experience, sweet and powerful as it is, never trumps Scripture, never has the authority of Scripture. But oh, if it's within Scripture, how sweet it is. Now, did you have an experience like that?
Yeah.
Did I hear, do I remember from supper you talking about it?
So.
Yeah, can you help me out down
okay.
here?
Okay. So as someone who grew up in a culture that sort of stressed the importance of kind of a mystical sense of calling. As a Southern evangelical in the Baptist tradition, and God was very kind and gracious to me to grant that to me, which is actually not at all according to my personality. I'm much more of a thinker than a feeler. But I walked into a worship service having never given thought to missions. I heard a mission speaker. She just recently died, just a couple of weeks ago, Dr. Helen Rosevier. Who informed me for the first time about unreached peoples. And back in the 70s, this was new stuff. Hmm. And I didn't realize what the world was like. I knew the Great Commission. I was convinced of the gospel. I rejoiced in the gospel. I cherished it. I was convinced that God had called me to some form of ministry. Walked in, never thinking about overseas. Walked out, and that was in June of 1979. And I have never doubted since that God wanted me to take the gospel to people who had never heard it. And that sense of calling really, I think, for my wife and me both, kept us on the field in times when it was hard. And there were times, I can remember literally the two of us weeping together because we just nothing was working the way we thought it would. And one of us would turn to the other and say, so, are we going back? And the answer was, no, God called us here. But here's what I've seen in working with literally hundreds of missionaries over the last 25 years, that God subjectively is not restricted to one pattern. And so I think there's some things about calling that we can all agree on. One is that any sense of calling to missions is rooted in the commands of Scripture. And it is circumscribed by the requirements of Scripture. So you got to start there. I think also there is a very real sense in which we put, beside the world, the word, we put the realities of the world. And, I mean, God broke my heart for lostness that night. And he's never let me get away from that. And I hope there is nobody here who can walk out of here without weeping over billions of people who are going to die and go to hell without ever hearing the gospel because we haven't taken it to them. And that's got to be part of the motivation. So there is simultaneously a passion for the glory of Christ and a passion for the salvation of the lost. Those two really were what came together in me to constitute my calling. And yes, there was a subjective sense, but to me, when I look back, it's objective. It feels objective in that with those two things, I had to ask myself, how can I not do this? And so I want to sort of flip things on their heads right now. And so we've agreed, I think, that all Christians are called in the sense that we are all called to Jesus. In consequence, we're called to holiness. We're called to service. Providentially, God has made many, including probably the majority of the people in this room, capable of going. They're physically capable. And under the guidance of their church, who are the ones who really have to affirm that they are qualified to go. And I want to add that church element very strongly here. But if you are capable and God at all has put in your heart an interest or a desire, then I think our default should be to go where we're needed more, unless he makes it clear we're to be where we're needed less. And so I would say, other things being equal, your default should be, I will go to the unreached unless God makes it clear that I shouldn't. And that's enough right there. The command of Scripture, the reality of lostness, the glory of the gospel should be enough.
But that just turns it upside down and creates the complexity of discerning how you're called to stay.
Right.
Same issues.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
How you feel about that?
Can I say something at this point?
It'd be great.
I'd love to have a go.
Anything.
Let's talk about marriage, though, for a minute. I just want to take it out of the heat of the calling and then come back to it, because I think there's a parallel. When I asked Jeanette to marry me, she said, okay. No. She said yes, right? She said yes. Now, did I know for certain, that she would be my wife at that point in time?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, I am.
No.
No?
Yeah, no.
Why did you say that, young David?
Because you weren't married yet.
Correct. So therefore, on the basis of my experience, she said yes, right? And we had months to prepare, everything, you know, there was nothing in terms of barriers as far as we could see, but until I say I will, I'm not married, am I? In fact, I've got the gift of singleness. By the way, the gift of singleness is your state. It is not this lack of libido or something like that. If you are single, you've got the gift. That's what Scripture says. That's it. Right? I've got the gift of marriage now because I'm married, but when I was single, I had the gift of singleness. Is that because I didn't want to be married? No, I was single. That's the gift. Anyhow, coming back to that, just a little hobby horse, but I wasn't certain, even though I was kind of certain. See, there's a subjectivity about that. So I want to draw that parallel back into this issue of calling to the mission field. There's a sense in which I can be subjectively clear about that. An earnest desire to go. It's very strong, but for whatever reason, God might prevent it, right? I pray for an unusual desire to go. I may, and I'll do everything I can, but for some reason, God might just stop me in my tracks. A friend of mine was all prepared to go to another part of Australia in Darwin. At the point he had all his furniture shifting over, he was struck with cancer of his lungs and given a year to live. Just stopped overnight. Everything was prepared for that, do you see? So I think pastorally what we want to help you, David, and everyone here to think through is, if you have this subjective sense, by all means, praise God for that. Praise God for what happened to Zane and others. And it's just the word calling that is filled with this ambiguity, I think. That is, I'm just wanting us to be very careful in how we use the language. How does the Bible use the word calling? And we've already said it over and again. He calls us to be Christian. He calls us to be holy. He calls us to be Christian. But the station in life that I'm in already, he says, called in that station of life. It's not a call to a vocation, as far as I read it. And interestingly, why do people always get called to be a doctor or a lawyer? I mean, that the Holy Spirit's only middle class, you know. Why can't the Holy Spirit call you to be a sewerage person, a garbage collector? I've never heard anyone say God's calling you to be a garbage collector. Not one, and not me at least. You may have. But the calling, I just think it's couched with that divine ought that may not necessarily be promised in Scripture. And that's the kind of thing that I think Kevin was getting at. And the other thing is when we look at Scripture and we see those evidences of where God did use people, and he did, all those evidences in the book of Acts, which John so helpfully pointed us to, the only caution I want to add to that is that they were descriptive passages there. Right? They did happen. Therefore, God can do that. He can say to you, don't go to Mesopotamia, go to Bithynia. He can say that, right? He can say, go to Bangladesh, don't go to India. He can say that. So we're not at all limiting the sovereignty of God. The question is that a divine imperative for all Christians? John's not saying that. I know he's not saying that. But I've just got to be careful, and you've got to be careful in thinking, is this descriptive or is this prescriptive for all Christians? So when we look at particular texts of Scripture, let's just be careful with how we understand guidance along those lines. But the word calling, for me, I've just got to check out, is that how the word is being used in Scripture itself? Whatever the word is, you know, it could be any sanctification. You know, what does that mean? Is it a progressive thing? Is it just a positional status? It's used differently. So just be cautious in how you just use the words the way the Bible intends to be, the way God intends to use the word. Is the only caution I want to bring to this discussion.
So when I read Acts 13 and I see the Holy Spirit set apart Paul and Barnabas, said, set them apart for the work to which I've called them. And I'm sitting here in this conference, and the only way I want to go overseas is if I know the Lord's calling me. I want to do whatever he wants me to do. So is he calling me to do that? I just want to be obedient. So I feel like I'm looking for a divine ought, in a sense, not in a biblical sense, because there's not a verse I can go to that says, go to Mm-mm. Nepal. Mm-mm. But the only way I want to pack up my family and move to Nepal, or as a student go to Nepal, is if the Lord is leading me to do that. So I'm longing for some assurance there. Is that right to long for?
Yeah, great. Praise God for that divine sense that's apparent. But check it out if it's the divine sense. For starters, he's impressed it on you. Praise the Lord. So go and check it out. Are you actually that passionate about Bangladesh? Then go and talk to people about that. Right. See if all these criteria fit and so on and so forth. Work with people who are wise and godly and helping you confirm that. But praise God for that sense that you're wanting to do anything. When you become a Christian, the normal discipleship is to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow Jesus. That's normal discipleship, isn't it? It's signing a blank check. So when I become a Christian, I to obey him whatever he chooses to do with me. Hmm. Praise God for that. If you have a divine sense of doing something or sense a compulsion and urgency, then go and check it out and do it. But if others tell me, oh, that's actually a bad idea, then I've got to listen to that too, because God can work through brothers and sisters to help me meditate through these things.
Let me say something about this, because again, I want to affirm the central role of the church as the sender. And the church functioning correctly knows your gifts, knows your strengths and weaknesses, knows the areas in which you need to grow, sees whether or not you are in fact working with internationals now, sees whether you are in fact sharing the gospel now. The caution I would make is simply this. Yes, by all means, take the advice of Christians. Make sure you take the advice of Christians who are fully committed to the Great Commission. Because I have been advised by Christians that I'm an idiot for doing what I've done with my life, because they are not sharing in the values of Christ. And so I realize I've just sort of contradicted myself in some ways. Don't go without the affirmation, the full-blooded affirmation of your church. But make sure the Christians you're listening to are Christians who are prepared and willing to say it's worth it for you to give up your life for the sake of the gospel.
So you're telling me it's really helpful for me to be in a healthy church that's on mission.
Yes.
With leaders who are going to shepherd me on
yes.
mission.
Absolutely.
And so that apparently needs to be important.
Essential.
In my life.
David,
that's
I was just
good. Thanks.
Just going to... The helpful stuff's down here, especially.
Yeah. I was hoping maybe you guys could come back.
I get to be on deck in just a few minutes.
You get the last word. That's good. I'll make sure to be there in the audience asking questions.
I'll just say, yeah, I mean, this is not the only description of how Paul moves. That's not to discount this. It is to keep in mind what Richard said about prescriptive versus descriptive. But he goes on, and there are four missionary journeys, if you count him going to Rome. And we don't see Paul agonizing over where the next step should be. We see some remarkable supernatural occurrences. Come over here to Macedonia. Don't go here. And as John said, we don't know. What was that Paul's way of describing circumstances that made it impossible, or was there a sense in which he just knew we're not supposed to go there? We don't know. Those things can happen. But we see Paul most often, in fact, almost always in the book of Acts, he decides to go to this city, and he has a regular pattern of preaching to the Jews first and then to the Gentiles, and then he goes to the next city along the geographic route, and then he'll come back and he'll visit the churches again. And he says that, you know, he doesn't want to go where Christ is already named, and he wants to go to Spain. And the sense we get is that Paul is a fully functioning human being with a will under the sovereignty of God, but he's making decisions about where to go and what to do. And along the way, all of that is under God's superintendence and guidance. But at each step, I don't see Paul agonizing about what the next city should be, or in anticipation that God, by the Holy Spirit, will tell him what that next city ought to be.
But it's so, I mean, Acts 20, he was constrained by the Spirit to go to Jerusalem. So the Spirit had totally given that to him at that point, right?
Well, yeah, you're the student. I mean, that's a
good question. Yeah, Aussie told me just to read the Bible and not care about what anybody else says, just read the Bible. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying that there's descriptive elements all throughout here, and it's not just one way that God is getting Paul where, in hindsight, we see that's exactly where God wanted Paul to go.
Let me
any other help before we close? We're going to have to, I've got to go pray something tonight. And I
Pull out an old cliche, it's easiest to steer a moving car. And I think it is perfectly appropriate to say, I have heard the imperative of the gospel. I have understood the needs of the world. I'm going to start moving in preparation with the expectation that God will do what is needed at each step. I'm not sure where I'm going to end up. I mean, if I could never have told you in June of 1979 anything about what my missionary career would actually look like. Hmm. But you just start moving. And so here I would say, hey, actually, you get your quarter, just do something. But do something that is purposeful, that is moving you toward greater and greater engagement with the Great Commission.
It's a good word.
So what I hear you brothers saying is be in the Word, like start there and stay there. And even, I loved how last 2 points tonight, John just pointed us to the relationship between the Word and the Spirit. So the more we are in the Word, the more familiar we are with the voice of God, the more in tune we are with the Spirit of God. So be in the Word. Seek him in prayer, like cry out to him for wisdom and for clarity and for his direction in my life. Lead me in your ways. Lead me in paths of righteousness. So in the Word, in prayer, and as he does, asking him to lead me, open to at some point, how might he lead me? How might he give me an answer to this question? Will involve things like learning more about the needs of the world, being exposed to opportunities there are for me to be a part of meeting those needs. And that's part of the point of this conference, is shining the light on the unreached and pointing to avenues for us to be involved. So explore opportunities for that. Ask, do I have gifts, skills, capability to do that? And be open to, subjectively, he'd given me a sense, but not expecting some particular, I've got to have this feeling at this moment, at this time. Like the facts, in a sense, are clear. The gospel's needed. I have the gospel. I'm open to going. So think through all those things in the context of a church with
brothers and sisters who will speak wisdom into me, who will see things that I don't see, and who will help me in discernment. And in that kind of process, the Lord will make it clear where and how he wants me to go.
Well, we really taught him.
Yeah. Didn't
we?
My last sentence would not be, "will make it clear where he wants me to go," but "will make me want it so bad I cannot not go." I think that's where the call happens. Your desire becomes irresistible. That's why anybody does anything.
I'm not going to ask you what you think. and all of us would say, you look in Scripture at these texts, and there's a mystery to how the Spirit says, "Don't go here, do go there." How did Acts 13 happen? The Spirit said, "Set apart for me, Paul." Was that an audible voice? Was that some kind of sound? There's mystery to it. But we all long for the tangible, like. I want that feeling, that sense, that unmistakable, the vision, man of Macedonia even, which we see in Scripture, like a vision. The Lord, I don't think, normally gives those, and I think he gives, and we think, well, that'd be easy. Like if we just went to bed tonight, everybody had a dream, came back in the morning, and who got one? I think we think that'd be easier and be like, oh, Lord, would you just do that? But he's designed something better. He's designed us for a relationship with him where we seek him as a part of his church, where we look at the world. And I think about him leading me from pastoring to this role, and I was wrestling through, am I supposed to go to Nepal? And it was 6 months of praying and fasting and seeking counsel from elders and with my wife in the Word every day in a Bible reading plan together, just wanting to, Lord, what do you want us to do? And 6 months later, we had a desire to go to the IMB. That was exactly what you just said, John. And I'm so thankful he didn't give me the vision at the first, because I love the Lord so much more 6 months later than I did at the beginning. And I knew him more, and I realized the goal is not just to make it, the goal is God. So I want to lead us in prayer for his leadership in our lives, all of our lives. We've talked at dinner tonight about how we're praying the same things you all are praying when it comes to our own lives and families. So let's go before him. Oh God, we need you. We need your wisdom. We need your grace. We need your mercy in our lives. We need you to, just as we needed you at that first moment when your Spirit caused us to say Jesus is Lord and you saved us from our sin, we need you to save us continually from our sin and ourselves. We want you to lead and guide our lives. Teach us your ways. Help us to walk in paths of righteousness. We want to obey you, and we thank you for giving us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for not even just giving us directions, but the director to lead and guide our thoughts and our desires and not just us, but others around us. You've given us the body of Christ to help point us to you and your will. So thank you for all these gifts. Thank you for not leaving us alone. Thank you for not leaving us in the dark. Thank you for loving us enough to lead and guide us. So we pray that it would be a reality in all of our lives. God, we pray for in each of us, I pray in my own heart and for all of us in this room, just a spirit of surrender to you, a yieldedness to you by the leadership of your Spirit that just says, I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want me to do. So we pray you would remove any hesitancy from us in praying that, any fear in us from praying that, or that you would draw us in deeper ways to yourself. I pray, it's come up at numerous times, and we've talked about calling to you, Lord Jesus, first and foremost, to pray for just deeper intimacy with you across this room. I pray for holiness in you across this room. I pray that you would open our eyes and our minds and our hearts to areas of sin in our lives that need to be rooted out and be confessed and cleansed, that you would do that tonight. And that as you make us more holy and you make us more like Christ, that you would lead us according to your wisdom and your will for your glory. Lord, we want to see your glory known among the nations. We want to see the nations be glad in you to know the gift of the Holy Spirit. So lead us however you will, and we trust you to lead us according to your goodness and your grace and your mercy. And so we have confidence, not in ourselves, but in your Spirit and your word in our lives. And in that we go into the rest of this evening, whether it's on deck time with John, or even after that, just time talking in church groups or time alone with you in prayer. Please continue to lead and guide us by your Spirit according to your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.